Your first guest today says the time is now for all things AI. His company, SandboxAQ, using AI to speed up critical drug development. Joining us is Jack Hidary. Jack, great to have you on.
Brian, good to see you.
I know you were just out west, by the way. I don't know how
just
you
landed.
Made it. I don't want to know. It's probably had something to do with AI. Okay. Is there any chance, because you're right in the thick of it with your company, any chance at all that all this hope and hype may take longer than we think?
Well, Brian, there's three key takeaways from Jensen's keynote on Tuesday. First, the demand for Blackwell is strong. He cited that just the demand from the cloud providers, the four biggest cloud providers, Google, Amazon, Microsoft, Oracle, is 3.6 million Blackwells versus Hopper. That's about 3x the Hopper demand. And he joked with his sales team right in the keynote and said, don't buy Hopper, buy Blackwell. His sales team was not happy with that, of course, but his point was that the demand for Blackwell, he claims that he's now beyond the Blackwell manufacturing issues and the production issues, and now they're delivering
Blackwell. That's their
Blackwell.
Super high-end chip.
That's right.
That Blackwell, is the Cadillac Escalade
that's
of
right.
NVIDIA chips.
25x the power, the compute power of a Hopper chip, and that's important for data centers because data centers need power. If you can fit the Blackwell chip in and have 25x the compute with the same basic electric demands, that's a win for the data centers. Second big takeaway, his key point on demand for compute is that reasoning models, these new models you're hearing from DeepSeek to OpenAI, the O1 model that has a chain of thought that gives you a more reasoned answer rather than just a quick answer, they need 150x the compute, Brian, than a regular quick spit out model. So his claim, what he's trying to convince the audience of, is that the demand is not only there now, it's growing because there's a demand for reasoning models, not just the quick model. And the final point he made is on networking, the speed in which you can move data around, and that's his announcement on silicon photonics, the quantum X chip. Not a quantum chip, but it's called quantum X. It's the first big silicon photonic chip, combining electrons and photons on the same integrated chip. So a lot to take in from Jensen's keynote. And his key point is that the demand is here now, not just coming in the future, particularly driven by reasoning models that need 150 times the compute than the normal models.
So for those who thought maybe they'd need less or could operate at the frontier, but I think to your point, there was a lot in there that he gave people and probably gave them what they needed to hear. You look at the stock, you look at the markets, they seem to have taken it in stride. That brings us to today.
Yeah.
Now he's making a reference to quantum. He says they're going to...
Today is quantum day. NVIDIA, yes, GTC, Quantum Day.
You know, I'm starting to get a handle on AI. Well, not really. And now comes quantum. They're going to open a quantum research lab in Boston, he says. We just showed the quantum stocks. They're in the red somewhat today. You know, the Rigetti CEO just said it's not good enough for any practical use. Jensen cut him off. Anyway, can you kind of give us the context around quantum, which at first NVIDIA seemed to poo-poo, is now saying we're cool on that too. And again, these other competitors, obviously, were like D-Wave is down 14%.
Yeah, so Jensen and NVIDIA has moved its estimates of quantum from the initial thing that he said, 15 to 30 years. He's now clarified that 5 to 15 years. And so that is actually more near term than he initially had talked about. I think he had the chance to talk to a lot of quantum companies, understand the milestones. Just in the last 90 days, we've had key milestones from Google with the Willow chip. We've had Amazon with the Ocelot chip. And we've had Microsoft with the Majorana 1 chip. That's three key milestones on error correction, bringing down the noise and errors in these quantum chips. That's the key to look at when you look at scaling quantum computers. The future is not quantum or GPU, it's GPU and quantum together.
Can I ask you something as well? So you were spun off from Google, were you not?
That's right.
Okay, so Google's biggest acquisition ever this week, by far.
Wiz.
$30
billion. $32
billion. Wiz, you know, and you're sort of...
Founded like 4.5 years ago.
Exactly, in 22... And I know you guys are sort of in the cyberspace. I don't know if we quite put it that way, because this is all getting very sophisticated.
Yeah.
But does that acquisition make sense to you? Or as we're talking about quantum and AI and all of this, does Google need to do something more clearly in the avenues of these two developing technologies?
Well, Google has a deep commitment, of course, to AI with Gemini, and has one of the biggest programs on quantum with its Willow chip. And again, the big demonstration from Google recently with Hartman and team is that as you scale the number of qubits, you can actually suppress those errors that pop up. That's the key metric we need to see happen as we scale from hundreds of qubits where we are today to thousands to millions
of qubits. So let me go back to sort of my take, and maybe I'm way off here. Okay. We've been talking about flying cars since the late 1960s. We've been talking about flying cars for 50 years. We used to have supersonic air travel, the Concorde. Now we don't.
Hopefully we'll have it again with boom.
Hopefully you must have it, I think, to get here on time. My only point is that given, and I know you're not a markets guy, Jack, but given all the attention around AI and all the money we're spending, which is propping up the stock market, is there any chance, are you confident that all the stuff we're talking about ultimately will have that last mile that enables this to occur? Because flying cars happen. They're possible. They're just not probable or profitable. And so we don't have them, but we should. Are you confident that AI will be there when we need it?
Brian, great question. I think the last 2 years was really about ChatGPT, about GPTs doing more consumer, prosumer work where you type in a prompt, you get back an essay, an email, a summary. The next 2 years is really about B2B. It's really about impact in pharma, in making new medicines and new diagnostics. It's really about energy. Aramco using AI now to take hydrocarbons from low-value fuels to high-value composites and higher-value products they can sell in the market. Their downstream is going to change radically in the next few years. It's talking about chemistry and energy and batteries. It's talking about the automakers. Jensen made an announcement yesterday about GM, 2 days ago about GM. You're going to see the automakers start to use AI, not just for autonomous, but also to lightweight the vehicles, to actually change the product itself. So the big, big demarcation point in AI is last 2 years is really about consumer AI. The next 2 years about B2B AI. Brian, that is a much bigger impact on the economy. That's 80%, Kelly, of the GDP.
Listen,
of the economy.
I'd rather have ChatGPT and Grok than flying cars, personally. I don't need the flying car. I'm good.
Because right. You would need a flying minivan.
And it's hard to innovate in the physical world. There's all these regulations. There's red tape, you know, but in the internet,
don't you think Congress
been...
is going to get a hold of AI? That's the part of the problem. They're going to muddle in, try to do what they do.
The next few years, I think we're not going to have... I don't think we're going to have a regulatory issue in AI in the current D.C. climate. I think that's actually not going to be a key issue. But right now, what we want to see, I think we're going to see in the next 2-3 years, is the impact of AI on the biggest sectors, on the B2B sectors. Last 2 years have been more B2C, next 2 years more B2B. And to your point, Kelly, about Wiz and cyber, that's, I think, where Quantum Day really comes in. As you see the scaling of quantum, as you see the scaling of AI, those are the two dream tools of hackers.
Mm-hmm,
hackers
exactly.
Love AI and quantum.
It's causing an arms race. If those are the dream tools of hackers, then companies now have to go to all these quantum.
It's an arms race. They got
to defend
that. That's right. They
it's
have
a
to defend.
Brilliant business model.
Yeah.
In some ways,
yeah.
We're going to push the vanguard, and then you'll pay us to defend you against us pushing the
exactly.
Vanguard.
So you see Google making a lot of bets, Amazon, Microsoft making bets, and now NVIDIA. Looking at that future of GPU plus QPU combined on the cloud. And those clouds, you already see happening. We see that integration on the cloud. Not only that, and also with DGX Cloud, which is, of course, the cloud of NVIDIA itself. So, you know, I think that Jensen's keynote made a number of key points. Mm-hmm. I think we do need to look at the reasoning models when we look at the demand for AI. But most importantly, the next 2-3 years, let's look at AI's impact on B2B and on the big, big industries of our society rather than just the B2C.
So. I love it. Aren't you excited now? It's coming. They're going to give us the flying cars and everything else.
I want both. I want AI and flying cars because the AI is going to make the car light enough that we can fit all of our families.
Right, I'll tell you this.
And zoom off somewhere, it's going to be great.
You're going to have to go to Dubai. Dubai is going to be the first spot. I'll save my prediction right here on CNBC. Dubai will be the first with some of the flying cars. So
Jack Hidary, Sandbox AQ, and flying car acolyte. We appreciate it. Thank you very much.